committee if you can do the needful with any electronic devices, and if there's any declarations of financial interests or other relevant interests to today's proceedings, now would be the time to declare it. If not, then we shall proceed. We any apologies at the moment. Some members, I think, are running late, so we're joined by Sinead Bradley, Gemma Dolan and Emma Rogan are all signed in to the Starleaf facility, and you're all welcome to the meeting. And at this stage, I'll ask the clerk if anyone has indicated a delegation of their vote.
Thank you, Chair. Gemma Dolan and Emma Rogan have delegated their votes to the Deputy Chairperson in the event that the Starleaf connection is lost.
Okay, thank you. Item two then, draft minutes of the meeting that was held on the 8th of October, pages 5 to 10 have the relevant pages in your meeting pack. And if members are content that they're a true reflection, then I will sign them accordingly. Members content? Some matters are rising, and there's a few items just members to go through. First one is the notes of informal meetings with individuals on the Domestic Abuse and Family Proceedings Bill. They're in the meeting packet, pages 12 to 25, and there's notes from three other informal meetings that were included in the table packet, pages 3 to 18. So the individuals are content that they're a true reflection of the discussions. A number of the individuals also provided additional written information following those informal meetings, and these have been appended to the relevant meeting notes. So if members are content, we'll note the summary of the meetings that took place with the individuals, and they'll be included in the appendices to the report on the bill. And again, members, we'll request for an additional meeting. There was a request for an additional meeting with a number of mothers who also wished to speak on their experience of domestic abuse and parental alienation, and that's at page 25 of the meeting pack. And members, I'd suggest to the committee that given the committee stage is completed today, we don't have any other plans to schedule additional meetings, but the matters raised in the email, they have already been subject to discussion during the committee's deliberations on the bill, and we'll advise people who contact us subsequently now to completion of our work, just of the issues raised and the processes that have been followed. Linda?
I agree with you in terms of the bill, and we obviously were all on the same page in terms of this issue in relation to this bill. But maybe at a future stage, it might be worth just keeping that on record, that at a future stage, if we're discussing issues around the family courts, because there certainly is an issue there that we need to look at, but it's not as part of this bill.
Okay, no, happy to do that. And again, I want to thank Linda, who headed up the other group that met with these informal meetings, so I know it was an additional bit of workload that we had to carry out, but I appreciate the way we divided that up between the two of us in order to get that information, so thank you for that. Another item then, there's an update from the Minister in respect to the positive COVID-19 tests on members of the healthcare team and in the prison service at McGilligan. The Minister provided updates on the 9th and 11th of October on a positive COVID-19 cases for members of the healthcare team and also the prison service then in McGilligan. So given the situation remain unchanged over the weekend, the Minister did not plan to make a statement to the Assembly but would keep this under review should the situation change. And these letters are pages 20 to 22 of the tabled pack. The Minister wrote again last night outlining the decisions taken by the prison service following announcements made yesterday from the executive in respect to the current situation, and that's on pages 23 to 24. So members, that information is there for noting. I know it's of concern to members what's happening in the prison service. It's something that we're keeping under active consideration. So if members will note that correspondence at this stage. Item 9 then of the matters arising is just a letter from the Clerk and Chief Executive of Mid and East Antrim Borough Council in respect of the support hub and the end of that funding stream. So we have that letter there in terms of a copy of correspondence that was sent to the community Head of Community Safety Division in the Department. The Council feels that the success of the hub has been evident since its inception from September of 2017, and the table pack has the relevant correspondence. So members, we did agree last week that we'd be asking the Department for information on the costs of the hubs and whether there had been a cost-benefit exercise undertaken. So that's a piece of correspondence that's outstanding. So we'll note the correspondence from Mid and East Antrim Council, but we'll pick this up again once we get a response from the department to the committee's letter. Item four then is the implementation plan for the Gillen review, the recommendations in respect of serious sexual offences. And we're going to have an oral evidence session now in respect of that. Pages 26 to 62 of the meeting pack has the relevant papers. We have officials who are joining us via Starleaf to outline the implementation plan for the Gillen review recommendations in respect of sexual offence, serious sexual offence cases. So hopefully they are here, and I can formally welcome Ms. Linda Hamilton, Deputy Director on the EU Exit and Victims Support Division from the Department of Justice, Ms. Angela Fitzpatrick, Head of the Gillen Review Programme Team in DOJ, and Ms. Julie Wilson, who is Head of Victims and Witnesses Branch and the Gillen Review Policy Branch within DOJ. And you're all very welcome to the meeting. And we will record this through Hansard, and then a transcript of that will be published on the committee webpage in due course. So I think, Ms. Hamilton, I'm going to hand over to you at this stage to provide an overview of the progress that is being made towards implementation of the Gillen Review. Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you, Chair. We are grateful for the opportunity to brief the committee on this today. I know committee members are very familiar with this review and its recommendations. However, I thought it would be helpful to draw out a few key points about our approach. So as the committee is aware, the Criminal Justice Board approved an implementation plan in June, and there is another copy of that in the annex provided to the committee for this meeting. The implementation plan set out our approach and identified the 14 strategic priority areas that we are currently focused on, and these centre around improving the experience of complainants in the criminal justice system. In his review, Sir John set out a vision of complex and whole-scale reform of the criminal justice system in respect of serious sexual offences, and this is nothing short of transformation, and this is what we must aim for. Of course, that means that the challenge of implementation is significant, that it takes time and resource, but more than that, reform on the scale that Sir John envisaged means that we have approached this in the following ways. We cannot do it alone. So it cuts across the whole criminal justice system and beyond. So we need to work in close partnership with other departments, agencies and support services. We can't do it all at once. So by this, I mean that while we have identified 14 separate priority areas, in reality, these are often interdependent. So implementation against one workstream may depend on progress being made in others. And Sir John himself has noted that. In short, we not only need to prioritise our efforts, but we need to choreograph them to ensure that transformation is sustainable. And we need appropriate oversight, governance and accountability. So in addition to the oversight provided by the Criminal Justice Board, we have established a strategic justice group on sexual harm, and that includes multi-agency representation as well as membership by support services. And that's to ensure our approach is joined up, coordinated and informed by best practice. So in terms of challenges, this is a challenging piece of work, and it might be helpful to touch on a few of those. So I mentioned the need for collaboration and partnership, and we do benefit from genuinely collaborative partners, but it does add to the complexity of the task. This is a systemic wide approach. So different agencies will address challenges from different perspectives, and at times will have competing priorities, and that is no more acute than during the pandemic. In addition, many aspects of the programme are new and quite innovative, so we need to research what has worked in other areas. That's within Northern Ireland and out with. And that's why we've been using pilots and phasing in many areas so that we can test and evaluate our approach to make sure they deliver the outcomes that we want them to. And then, as with every aspect of society, COVID-19 has added to the complexity and challenge of delivery, placing additional pressures on resource, and has had a significant impact on the justice system as a whole. Perhaps most importantly here, in the context of the Gillen Review, has been the consequential impact on victims. And on this, I want to reassure committee members that reducing this impact on victims and witnesses has been a key factor in the department's work to recover the justice system. And officials have been engaging with Victim Support Northern Ireland, NSPCC and other stakeholders on a regular basis as that recovery plan has developed. So in terms of progress, We are making progress. We have completed 14% of the Gillen recommendations, and we want to see that figure increase. There is a huge amount of ongoing work across the wide range of work streams currently in train. The vast majority of Gillen recommendations are now owned across the system and are being taken forward. The written paper that we provided to the committee gave a summary of progress across all 14 strategic priority areas. However, I want to mention a few key ones that will come to fruition this financial year. The establishment of facilities for the provision of remote evidence by children and vulnerable or intimidated adult victims and witnesses. And we're taking a phased approach to this with a view to having remote facilities in place by the end of the year. The establishment of a pilot scheme that will make publicly funded separate legal advice available to adult complainants in cases involving serious sexual offences. And we aim to launch that by the start of the next financial year. And then, of course, the draft committal reform bill, which committee members will know was seen by Sir John as a critical part of the reform he envisaged by reducing delay and preventing vulnerable victims from having to give oral evidence at committee. And this is just a small taste of the work the department is taking forward. If I may, the last point that I wanted to make is while the Gillen review is, of course, a priority for the department, it exists within a wider framework of victim needs and issues, so not just serious sexual crime victims. The review very clearly articulated the particular needs of victims within the criminal justice system. There is a significant read across to the wider needs of all victims, and there are opportunities for measures that fall under the Gillen recommendations to have a wider application and to deliver improved outcomes for other victims as well, those who may be equally as vulnerable. So similarly, as the department and its partners develop and refresh our strategic response to the needs of more of victims more generally, there will be learning from that process that can help to inform our implementation of Gillen. And it's for that reason, to harness the synergies and opportunities, that the department has gone through some internal restructuring so that as of July this year, responsibility for wider policy on victims and witnesses now also sits within my division. I hope this has helped to provide an overview to committee members taken alongside the papers that we provided, and we're happy to provide further detail on anything that I have mentioned or answer any of the committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and that has been helpful. In terms of the 86% still then to be completed, is there a time frame as to when that's going to be achieved? And what are the key barriers to overcoming for its implementation? By that I'm meaning legislative provision in particular that may be required.
So you have seen the implementation plan, which sets out the vast majority of things that are going to be taken forward by the department. So over 70% of those recommendations are ongoing. I think we've tried to stage those as best as we can, and with a view to this programme lasting for 5 years, but you will start to see real game changes for victims over the next. We'll see some when remote evidence centres come in, and then we'll see them at the start of the financial year when we start to see separate legal advice being available. We have tried where possible, particularly in terms of legislation, Chair, to include some recommendations where appropriate into the Miscellaneous Provisions Bill that the Department hopes to put through in 2021. There are other things that require legislation, such as changes that Sir John recommended in relation to consent, and those would be taken forward in the next mandate.
Okay, thank you. In terms of the remote evidence centres, is there a number as to how many you expect to establish across the province?
So at the moment we're focusing on Belfast, and once we get that up and running, we'll learn lessons from how that is working and then establish what the need is across the system, because there are different ways of doing it. You know, there will not be the need to have a remote evidence centre for every court, for example, but I suspect we may need two or three across Northern Ireland to make sure that there is a geographical spread of that offering in relation to victims across Northern Ireland.
Okay, and in terms of the pilot scheme that had been set up around the voluntary protocol that Judge Smith had laid around expediting sexual offence cases for children under 13, that has came through as a success. But I note that the pilot scheme is being extended. At what point will that become a permanent scheme that is then implemented?
So that, you're absolutely right, that scheme has been extended for another year. There's a small number of cases covered by that, but it absolutely has been seen as a success. So the plan is to run that for another year, and as that happens, that will form an important part of the development of wider provision for children in these cases, which is known as the Barna House system. So a one system approach for children who are victims of serious sexual crime, wraparound services that need to be developed in Northern Ireland. And I would very much envisage that pilot would form part of a more sustainable model for children as we move forward. And there will be other things that form part of that in the Gillen review, like remote evidence and how that's taken forward for children, how children get appropriate advice and support. So all of those things should come together in the coming years to provide a more permanent model for children.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in other members now at this stage, and I'll invite Linda Dillon.
Thank you, Chair. I have a number of questions on this. It's an area that I actually am very focused on. Just to follow on from the Chair's last question around the pilot, because I had noted that as well, that it's been extended for another year as a pilot. I'm always concerned when I say that, because if a pilot is agreed by all parties as something that works and is good, why is it still a pilot? You know, why has it not been implemented? And I understand what you're saying, that you would be hopeful that it becomes part of the bigger picture, but there's no reason why then we don't implement it now, and it will still become part of the bigger picture. It doesn't need to be a pilot. It really concerns me when I see things as a pilot, and we see it all the time right across departments,
and it
really frustrates me, because we could pilot the life out of things and never implement anything. And I would be concerned that would be seen as something that's forming, you know, that is making recommendations, and if it drops off the edge of the table, then it has that is no longer being met, but we've missed it because we thought it was being dealt with. So I'm just making that point. I don't even expect you to come back on that, but at some point we do need to look at the issues around pilots and why you would bother piloting something if you're not going to be able to implement it, because that is obviously resource intensive. Just the scoping work in relation to previous sexual history, I'm not really sure that I understand what that means. So if I could have a very, very brief outline of what exactly that means.
Sorry, you dropped off there. We didn't hear that question.
Sorry, Linda. The scoping of work around the previous sexual history, I'm not really sure what that means. So I just would like a wee kind of an outline of what exactly that means.
Okay, just to come back on your previous point, because I do think it's important, I just want to reassure the committee that the needs of children here will definitely not drop off. The development of a whole system approach for children is one of Sir John's key recommendations. We've got it as a priority. So, you know, I understand the members' concern about pilots being extended, but, you know, I want to absolutely reassure that there is no question of that dropping off as a priority. Turning now to previous sexual history. The use of previous sexual history is something that I think victims, when they are going to court, are really, really understandably nervous about, and there should be a really small number of cases where it is appropriate that information is used as evidence. What is not clear or particularly easy to get a handle on is the number of times that is being used in Northern Ireland. So there are formal processes in legislation by which a defence counsel should go through in order to be able to use previous sexual history in court. But there are also more informal routes for that to be done in the courtroom itself. So what we need to do is understand, A, what is the prevalence of this and how often is this being done? And then B, what is the solution to that? So making sure that it is always being used in only the appropriate cases. And there will be some where previous sexual history is relevant, but by and large, in the majority of cases, you would assume that it wasn't. And there are a number of partners that have a role here. There's a role in training. So training judges, training the bar, training PPAs. There is a role for PPAs in ensuring that they have a view when the defence moved to use previous sexual history, and then there is a tie-in to the separate legal advice work that we are doing, because victims will, from the start of next financial year, will be able to talk to an independent lawyer who acts for them about the use of their previous sexual history in court. So there's quite a lot to this, and I suspect, you know, this is an issue which worries victims. You know, it's high on the agenda for them, but there may be myths around this as well, that it doesn't come up in the majority of cases. So there could be some communication that needs to be done here as well, once the facts are established, that may actually provide some comfort to victims as they come forward to report sexual crime.
Thank you, Linda. Just then, in relation to the Barnahus type model, and it does appear to be a very positive way to move forward, but I note that it says it will be used in serious sexual offence cases, and I'm wondering what defines a serious sexual offence case, because I acknowledge that obviously there is differences in the types of sexual offence that might happen, from maybe exposure to right through to serious and sustained abuse. But I think that a child being exposed to any type of sexual offence is a serious matter, so I'm just wondering what... And I think that they would all need some level of this, whilst some would need, obviously, much, much more greater support. I would accept that. I would feel that all children would need some level of it.
Yeah, and I think that's what the Barnahus model does. So the Barnahus model will take a sort of bespoke look at that child's needs, and then determine what wraparound support they need as a result of what's happened to them, as a result of how they are feeling, as a result of their vulnerability. So that, you know, will allow for psychologists to assess that child and to provide the support that's required around that. I'm going to pass over to my colleague Julie Wilson, who leads on the Barnahus initiative, in case she has anything else to add to that.
No, I think that's exactly right. It is about providing a tailored response to the needs of that child. So when we've used the terminology of serious sexual offences, we've been just picking up on the language of the Gillen Review itself, but it is about providing a holistic response to the needs of children in sexual offence cases.
Okay, thank you very much. And just then, I think I have one other question in relation to the indictable cases process, the agreement with PPS. I'm just wondering why that agreement hasn't yet been reached. What are the barriers to that happening?
So I think we need to have a very detailed dialogue with the PPS around ICP. The difficulties in rolling out ICP in the way that it is, that it currently exists for other crime types, is that sexual cases are more complicated in certain respects around the use of mobile phone technology, for example. So I think, you know, what we have agreed after some, you know, good in-depth conversations is that we need to develop a more bespoke ICP model for sexual offences that take into account some of the complexities involved. I think this is a really important issue here, because it gets to the heart of the delay in serious sexual offence cases, and also trying to get all parties to talk about the key issues at stake at trial, to try to limit the issues that need to be brought through in evidence, and also to agree evidence where appropriate. I think the other thing, just for the committee to be aware, is that in serious sexual offence cases, you may be less likely to get a plea from a defendant, and that also, you know, the ICP process can be designed to try to narrow the issues, and it may end up in a plea. That is more difficult in serious sexual offence cases. So I think, you know, I would say to the committee that there's quite a bit of work that needs to be done on that, and PPS have been quite nervous around the development of ICP as it stands in relation to serious sexual offence cases, but are more than happy to accept the development of a more bespoke model, and that's something that we hope to do relatively quickly, and that will that will feed in nicely, I think, as well to the work that's been done in committal, which will also seek to reduce the delay in these types of cases.
Thank you. There are two things that I would like to get back in writing, if it's possible, Chair. Just who is on the departmental or the cross-departmental and interagency working group on the education and awareness?
Yeah.
And who, when you speak about training at J and 15J, who will that training be delivered to? And just finally, you see, in terms of the myth busting around rape, I'm assuming that is wider, because you've said in the brief that it's wider than jurors, they get that. So yeah. Are we talking about public? Are we talking about some kind of publicity campaign around this?
That's exactly what we're talking about. So I think when you speak to Sir John about this, and when you look through the report, thematically he is very clear this is not just a criminal justice issue. And if we want to look at prevention, which is presumably the space that will be, you know, incredibly effective, it comes down to thinking about cultural issues, about people feeling that they can report things or say that things aren't acceptable. I'm going to pass over to Angela just to talk a bit more about this. We were involved in a public-wide sort of campaign around consent, but I'll pass over to Angela, who can talk a bit more about that.
Thank you. Just in relation to the education and awareness, there are a number of strands to that working group, one of which is the one that you have mentioned. In relation to Sir John, one of the recommendations stated that he wanted a public and a school's education and awareness campaign, specifically in and around rape myths. There are a number of other strands that he wants included in that, in and around consent. The fact that sometimes it wouldn't be a stranger, it's normally a person you know, that people would freeze, for example, rather than fight. So there's a number of aspects to the campaign he wants. And it's to be targeted to the public in one sense. There's also the education and awareness then for schools. So it's linking into the existing RSE, relationship and sexual education curriculum, and the learning for life, because there's other issues in and around how we use social media. So there are a number of issues in and around the education and awareness, but specifically on rape myths, Sir John has been very clear that he wants it to cover rape myths.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. You're okay. I'm going to bring in Sinead Bradley.
Okay. Hello, can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for the report. I know lots of people in the committee, including myself, have been eager to have this update. In terms of the remote evidence centre, could I have a better understanding of what will that look like? What will a remote evidence centre be? Is it an office? Is it a home type environment? What are the ambitions for that? And I also would be cautious, talks about a vulnerable complainant. Who determines that? Is that set somewhere in law? Is there a guide to who would determine who a vulnerable complainant is? And I suppose the third one is then there's a list there of provisions that the Minister's considering taking forward in the Justice Miscellaneous Provisions Bill. Is that an exhaustive list, or is that a sort of work in progress and is likely to change? Thank you.
If I come back to you on the remote evidence facility, so there are already live links within courts that can be used under special measures legislation, and so the idea is that a vulnerable or an intimidated victim or witness or child witnesses don't need to actually give their evidence in the courtroom. They can give them remotely via live link, but those live links are situated within the court building itself. There is in the Northwest, there's one existing live link in Bishop Street, so and it would be used, and it's just across the road from the courthouse, so that would be the closest thing that we currently have to a remote evidence centre, and it's located within NSPCC property. And it's managed by NSPCC. The idea with the Remote Evidence Centre is ultimately it would be what we're looking at is a facility with separate facilities for children and adults. So there'll be live links, which are live link suites, which would be essentially for children to use, and others for adults. And then with that, there would be supporting infrastructure around that, so waiting areas, consultation rooms. So So the victim or witness won't need to go to the court building. It won't be in a home, it won't be in a domestic setting, and that's about also providing a secure space for victims and witnesses where they can be also supported by the witness support services to provide their evidence, but in a space which is where we can assure that there's no witness tampering going on, so not in a domestic setting. It would be using the existing live link technology with the courts, but from a location which is set apart from the court building. Essentially, in order to get some facilities in place, we're taking a phased approach to this, so we intend to kind of build it up incrementally. So initially, we'll be working on a kind of lower capacity facility, which kind of corresponds to the fact that the court services and the business through courts is slower at the minute anyway. But we want to ensure that we do have those remote facilities in place from the end of the year. So it will start as modest provision, and then we're working on a more sophisticated interim model, which will be in place for a number of years. And then, as Linda has mentioned, we want to look then at what the provision outside of Belfast should be. So, and we'll want to be informed by that process that we're going through at the minute as to what the best way to do that is, where they should be located. There is guidance available on what the facility needs to cover on making sure that the facilities for children, for example, are child friendly, and that there's breakout rooms if a child has to give evidence for a long period of time, that they can take a break in a room without going back into the waiting room where they would be in touch with other people. So there is guidance about how to do that, which we're being informed by as well.
And then if I can just come in, just the other bit of that question, I think, is the court will decide how people give evidence, and victims will have a view on that. There will be some victims who want to give evidence in court. They may not want to give evidence remotely, and that, their views will be taken on board. In relation to the miscellaneous provisions bill, that is being developed. The approach that we've taken with that is to have a look at the recommendations in Gillen that require legislation and that also are suitable for the scope of a miscellaneous provisions bill. So there are I think four or five. There's some, the one that I would see in there that's the most significant is the ability to exclude the public from hearings when people are given evidence in serious sexual cases. So instead of a packed courtroom, there is a much smaller number of people in the room, whether that evidence is given remotely or otherwise, so that you don't have a kind of being mob when people are trying to give to tell the story. So those provisions we hope to see introduced in early 2021. I think I don't see us. I think we've done a fairly interrogative a view of the Gillen review and what may be appropriate for the miscellaneous provisions bill. So I don't see us adding huge number of other things in there because I don't think they're suitable for that bill. And a good example of that is just the recommendation around consent. I think that is much more suitable in a wider sexual specific bill in the future.
Thank you, Chair.
Okay. Thank you, Sinead. Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Linda, Angela and Julie. Really informative, I've got to say. So much to go through. Listen, I've just got sort of one question, but there's two parts to it. The first one is, I'm just reading the separate legal advice where it says publicly funded legal advice for the complainant, and the complainant being the victim, and the victim being the evidence in many ways. But it goes on to say, with a basic entitlement to relevant information, basic entitlement. Is there no movement in the complainant stroke victim allowing to have their own legal representation in the court with them? And the second part is as well, has there been any movement at all on the defendants, where there's a case of multiple defendants, that those defendants, solicitors, or legal representatives asking the same question repeatedly. So four defendants and four solicitors asking the same question of the victim, which can be quite a complex answer that they have to give and could create an awful lot of confusion, which could undermine the victim. Any movement in those two areas?
So if I can take your first one about legal representation. So John himself actually doesn't recommend that the system goes full scale, first of all, into allowing the victim to have representation in court during the trial. What he recommends is that, first of all, there is publicly funded legal advice available to the victim, normally around Article 8 issues, so access to their phones, previous sexual history, access to medical records, things like that. He doesn't envisage that victim being represented at trial in the first instance. What he says is that let's try that first stage initially, see how it goes, and then we may move to a stage further on down the line when we may want to think about legal advice at trial. So I think he envisages that two-stage approach, and that is the approach that we've taken.
On your second question, Linda, can I just jump back on that quickly? So, and I get what you've just said, and you know, don't dispute that whatsoever. But where we talk about basic entitlement, is that basic entitlement always going to be there? So if the trial is a long, protracted 6 to 8 weeks trial, will that claimant, defendant, victim, have the ability to link into that advice all of the time? So, you know, or is it just the basic advice at the start of the trial and that's it?
So I think that's a really good point. I think the issues that are discussed at trial should be ironed out pre-trial, and that's where Sir John envisages the advice being crucial. But because of the method that we have taken to rolling this out, it will be part of a wider package. So there will be legal advice in that package, but there will also be wider advocacy support, and by that I mean non-legal advice, so support and emotional encouragement and all of those things, all provided by victim support. So I'm not sure that, you know, we will see how this goes, and I think that's a really good point actually around what happens if an issue comes up during the trial that the victim needs advice for. I would envisage that in the model that we have, they will be able to access that, no problem at all, and they'll have an existing relationship with victim support and with that lawyer that they've had pre-trial. So I don't think there's an issue with that at all. I think the only, you know, the only issue will be that they will not necessarily have a right to appear. You know, that they will not have the right to a barrister appearing on their behalf necessarily, although that is also something that we need to work through quite carefully, particularly as we move to consideration of the next stage of Sir John's approach, which is to think about issues and representation during the trial.
And the second point?
And then the second point that you raised about victims being subjected to effectively the same cross-examination but from a slightly different perspective. I think there are decisions there for those operational partners around how cases are prosecuted. In some cases it may make sense to prosecute cases with a number of defendants together. I think this comes down to training, and I think this comes down to the approach and judicial management that judges take operationally and how cases flow through in terms of the questions at trial. It may be perfectly legitimate, of course, for evidence to be tested, but that has to be done in an environment where the victim's well-being is also considered. And I think that definitely forms part of some of the training considerations and also the protocol that went out to judges in November, which talks about treating victims with dignity and thinking through their experience in the court. I'm not sure that you can legislate or make specific rules in relation to those cases. I think it comes down to how they're managed in the courtroom.
Okay, fair one. Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Doug. Rachel Woods.
Thank you. A lot of my questions have already been addressed, so I have only a few here. Just with, to start at the end, in terms of the resources, the 10 million, that's over the next 5 years rather than the whole cost of the entire of the Gillen review. or it's just for the next 5 years of the project, of rolling out the implementing the recommendations. And in terms of the implementation plan, said that it was 1.6 million for implementation stage, and this is 1.3 million. Is there been 300 grand siphoned off there somewhere, or is that an error?
I'm going to pass over to Angela, but I suspect it's not 300,000 being siphoned off. I suspect it's just that it may not be spent. And then your previous point about the 10 million, we envisage that this review will be implemented in 5 years, so there will be ongoing costs after that, but they should revert into business as usual costs as the system, as this becomes a sustainable part of the system. Angela.
Hi, just I think to follow on from what Linda said, yes, the 10 million is our initial, if you like, estimate of what we expect it to cost over the full lifetime of the programme, which is 5 years. Obviously, there's a lot of work still to be done. We have a strategic outline case in place which set out that cost. It broke it down as best we could into the annual costs, and the 1.3 million would be this year's costs. I'm just flicking through the paper here to see where 1.6 is coming from. On the actual plan itself. Certainly in the note that we sent to the committee, we indicated that it was 1.3 million for this year. Now, in addition to that, we would have had our own existing baseline costs in Gillen, which would have brought that probably up to the 1.6. Linda's passed me over. Yeah, 1.6. I think that is the 1.3 was the additional money needed in addition to the money that we would have already had baseline within the Gillen team themselves. So the 1.3 would be largely to resource our partners really to deliver and input into the implementation plan.
Okay, thank you. Specifically then on the training, I know Linda had some questions about who it was been delivered to. Certainly be interested in that. But also about the education and awareness piece you'd mentioned about this being sort of schools involved as well and going into existing RSE. We know that RSE is full of problems and gaps between schools, so and you know, some schools don't get any form of RSE, let alone ones that would touch on any issues to do with Gillen. So I'm wondering what is going on with the Department of Education to ensure that every single school will have the same level of RSE with regard to the recommendations.
Yeah, happy enough. As I mentioned already in the education awareness, it's a very wide range of work stream covering the wider public awareness, but in particular the focus on RSE and education in our schools, that's age appropriate. And as I said already, there is an RSE hub available through the CCEA, and schools have the opportunity to avail of that. And you're quite right in saying that some schools make more use of that than others, and that's part of the issue we're looking at in terms of a consistent approach across the piece. And our colleagues in Department of Education are sitting with us on the wider workstream, which has only had a couple of meetings to date, and we're working with individual representatives on that group to find out the detail of what's actually contained and available in the RSE, to see does it meet what Gillen has suggested we should cover in RSE, and if not, then to identify how best we could address the gaps and also get schools to be more interested, if you like, in availing of the resources that are already there. And it's really coming from and focusing on a child protection aspect of this, in that if we don't educate our children, there is the possibility we'd be creating victims but also create perpetrators in the lack of education and awareness.
Yeah, absolutely. Certainly be interested in hearing more about that as it goes on. In terms of the research, there a point, sorry, I'm just in the plan here, research that was subject to delay or just has been temporarily deferred to focus on the delivery of the Remote Evidence Centre for Belfast. Is that still, that work stream sort of still going on this year, or is that something that's going to be going on into next year?
I think research by its very nature will probably take us throughout this programme, because there are some baselines that we just don't have. I talked earlier about, for example, the number of cases where previous sexual history is used, and there are a number of other areas of research that are ongoing that are important, but also potentially some that we need to start. We've got some good relationships with academics in Northern Ireland and beyond, and I think, you know, the Remote Evidence Centre is something that is a key priority and sits in Julie's team, but the research you know, we fully intend to pick that up, and I think that will be something that will run for the full extent of this and beyond, to be honest, particularly if new crime types come through as well. We can see the use of technology, for example, in sexual crime, and that is something that we will also need to think about.
Great, okay.
If I could just chip in, sorry, on the back of that. Linda's already said we have quite a few contacts linked into the Education and Awareness Working Group with academics in Queen's who have taken forward a lot of research in relation to consent, for example. So, as I said, it's kind of coming on board as necessary with the existing work streams. So there's an awful lot of, and to have the evidence base to make recommendations in terms of education and awareness, it's important we have the academic research along with the practicals for what programmes are currently available and how effective they are.
Okay, thank you. Just finally, it was on following on from a point that Doug was talking about with regard to the legal advice. I take it this pilot, would this be changing any form of legal aid as part of this pilot, or it's not subject to means testing or anything like that? How's that being rolled out?
Yeah, so this is a universal thing, and victims may choose not to avail themselves of it. I think if we wanted to do it through legal aid, there would be such a large lead-in time that we wouldn't be able to provide that from the start of the next financial year. Interestingly, just on that point, we've been liaising with models that of similar type in different jurisdictions, and they maybe have started with a legal aid approach and have decided not to do that and have gone with the sort of model that we are looking at. So it may well be, once we've tried this, that, you know, it points us towards legal aid in the future, but there will be a lead-in time to that, and we didn't really want to wait. We want people to be able to avail themselves of this as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Gordon Dunn.
Yeah, apologies for being late, Chair. Just a quick point, maybe it has already been mentioned. The jury trials have been paused due to COVID, but are resuming. Have they resumed, or it's said here to be kept under review?
Yeah, so I think jury trials are starting now. I think the point here is how that they are listed in relation to vulnerable victims. So the wider work on recovering the justice system is really important, because we need to make sure that vulnerable victims are not subject to longer delays than possible. So where appropriate, I think it's important for operational partners to think carefully about the first cases, if you like, that start to kick off in Northern Ireland post-COVID, that those are chosen carefully, and that vulnerable victims, are their considerations are played into that as cases are listed.
Okay. The case progressions officers, are they new posts, or are people being retrained for those?
So I think they'll be covered by existing staff, but carrying out a new function. So making sure that these types of cases are managed, and that there's a grip of them, and that they are continually pushed forward to try to combat delay, and to ensure that, again, the victims' need for these things to progress and conclude is taken into account.
Okay, obviously that's an important role. Case progression, do they liaise with the victims directly, or do they work through their legal representatives?
No, they are in place to liaise with the operational partners who are responsible for getting the cases to court. So PPS, the defence, and it's all about the court taking a proactive role in pushing those cases forward and ensuring dates are set for hearings and that there is momentum. Proactive momentum from the court side in pulling the system along to get the cases through.
Okay, thanks for the presentation. Thanks, Chair.
Okay. Linda, you just wanted to follow up?
It's just a very tiny point on something that Rachel rose there around schools and the education, and we know all the complications. I suppose two things. Obviously, I would like to think that it's not just about schools, it's youth services as well, which has a reach into many that maybe don't engage well at school as well. But there was a programme rolled out called the Pants Talk, which was a very, I think, very good, very effective, very simple, but really, really effective. And I'm speaking as a parent and somebody who thought, that's brilliant. That makes it so easy for me to have that conversation with my child. So I think if there was something like that, I'm not talking about just that, I mean, in addition to everything else that you would be doing, something like that would be really, really good. And I know this is not a simple issue, so it's not easy, but neither was the pants talk stuff. But it was simplified down to what, and then you can expand as a parent on that in whatever way you see fit. But something like that, I think, would be really, really good. And then for those schools that don't engage in the way they should, and I don't know why any school wouldn't be engaging fully, but maybe that's something that needs to be considered. Is it a programme that goes into schools through youth services or something, rather than every school deciding what wee bit they take and how they deliver it? That might be a better way to do it. And then, obviously, you know, something like this in addition for those parents who aren't satisfied with how their school is dealing with the issue, but wants to be very sure that their child knows what a healthy relationship looks like, whether they're a potential perpetrator or a potential victim. Thanks very much. The presentation and the brief was excellent.
Okay. Maybe just to come back briefly on that, we do have youth services are represented on the Education and Awareness Workgroup, and NSPCC, I think, who are responsible for the PANS talk material, are on the group, along with a range of other people, Nexus. There's a whole range, we'll send you through the membership of that, and to reassure you that we are conscious that there is a target audience here in between the public and the education schools for those who are not in employment or education, and that kind of key youth sector. So we are going to get a representative from the Youth Forum to join a group which is a young person themselves, and through maybe sports groups. So consideration of all of that. At the minute, we're at the stage of gathering all the evidence really to see what's currently out there in terms of academia, and in a practical sense, what's there for all the ages that it needs to be targeting right up to universities, for example. And then it's evaluating how effective that is, and then potentially designing something new, or perhaps there's already something in existence that we can use, and also looking at other jurisdictions and what they use, because there's a range of material actually in place. So we may not need to reinvent the wheel. There's probably something already out there. So that's the position in relation to that.
Chair, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. And if I can thank the team there in the department for the oral evidence session this afternoon, it's much appreciated, and one that I'm sure we'll follow up on in due course. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks. Okay, members, there's a couple of points I think that we're going to get back in writing, so we'll have to take a note of that just to make sure that we get that followed up on. We'll move on to the next session then, members, which is item 5, proposals to amend legislation governing retention of DNA and fingerprints, the outcome of the consultation and proposed way forward. So we've got officials again joining us via the Starleaf facility. The relevant papers for members are pages 64 through to 119. So hopefully the officials are maybe changing over the table in the department, but we should have Moira Campbell, head of the Policing, Policy and Strategy Division from the department, and William Duclos, head of Police Powers and Human Resources from the DOJ. Okay. That was good to know before I started continuing any further. So members, just take your ease for a minute while the DOJ officials wipe down the table. We're able to have the department brought into the spotlight, and then we can see. Thank you. Okay, members, so just as Moira and her team take their seats, I'll remind you again, pages 64 to 119 of the meeting pack has the relevant information. So, Moira, I'm not sure if you've got your team ready to go.
If you like, Chair, I can start with opening comments and hopefully colleagues will have joined me by the time I've completed those.
I have every faith that you can manage without them if they don't, but yes, thank you for volunteering to take on the role. So please, if you want to provide an overview, then we'll take it from there.
Okay, Chair, rather than detain you, and thanks very much. We're grateful for the opportunity to brief the committee today on the outcome of the public consultation on proposed changes to the law on the retention of DNA and fingerprints. And I thought it might be useful to start just by explaining briefly the current state of play on biometric retention. So as things stand, DNA and fingerprints taken under PACE legislation may be held indefinitely. And that will be the position until we're able to commence a new retention framework that was set out in Schedule 2 of the Criminal Justice Act, Northern Ireland 2013. That piece of legislation was the Department's response to a judgment by the European Court of Human Rights in the case of S and Marper versus UK, which found that the indefinite retention of DNA and fingerprints of persons arrested but not convicted of a recordable offence was in violation of Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights. Schedule 2 of the 2013 Act introduces rules that determine how long the DNA and fingerprints of someone may be retained, depending on the seriousness of the offence, the age of the offender, and their criminal history. To date, it hasn't been possible for us to bring these provisions into operation, and that's because if we did, a large volume of material relating to non-convicted persons would fall for deletion from the police databases, which may be needed in the future for legacy investigations. The Stormont House Agreement Bill, which was out for consultation some time ago, as you may be aware, would have allowed this material to be retained for the sole use of the proposed Historical Investigations Unit, but as you know, the Secretary of State has since published fresh proposals, and so we're still awaiting a legislative solution for the retention of material that may need to be retained for legacy investigations. And then in February this year, the European Court of Human Rights found in the case of Cochrane versus UK that retaining indefinitely the DNA, fingerprints and custody images of convicted persons was also in violation of Article 8 of the ECHR. And that meant that key elements of what we had in the 2013 legislation have now been rendered non-EHR compliant. And that's why we're now proposing changes to the retention framework in the 2013 Act. And we are hoping to make those changes in the forthcoming Justice Miscellaneous Provisions Bill. So that's just by way of the context and background. And just to outline what the main changes we're proposing are, firstly, we're proposing to replace indefinite retention with maximum periods of retention, to provide a regulation-making power that would allow us to create a new review mechanism, to provide for DNA and fingerprints to be retained where a recordable offence was committed outside the UK, to allow DNA and fingerprints taken for an offence that has been what's referred to as left on books by the court to be retained for 12 months, and to widen the scope of the post of Northern Ireland Commissioner for the retention of biometric material. So we carried out an 8-week consultation on those proposals, which ended on the 20th of August. A total of 34 responses were received, and overall, around half of the responses were broadly supportive of the proposals, though some raised concerns on points of detail. The majority of those who were opposed to the proposals were in favour of continuing to retain biometric material indefinitely. But since that wouldn't comply with the European Court's judgment, to do so would be unlawful. We've considered carefully how we might respond to the concerns raised during the consultation. And I just want to set out briefly what we're proposing to do in response to some of the issues that were raised. The first is in relation to the maximum retention periods. And some people felt that those periods, which are 75, 50 and 25 years,
were too broad and disproportionate. And some made the point that the two higher bans could effectively amount to lifetime retention. The ban that appeared to attract the most concern was the 50-year period, because we were proposing that quite a wide range of offences would fall within that band. What we're now proposing to do is to amend the model so that the material relating to adult convictions for non-qualifying offences that don't involve a custodial sentence should be moved down into the 25-year band rather than remaining in that 50-year band. That would mean that material for adult convictions that attract a custodial sentence would remain within the 50-year ban. There was broad support for the review mechanism, though some people would have liked more detail on what this might look like. We're currently looking at a couple of potential options for that, and we'd be happy to give a bit more detail on our current thinking on that today, but we will be bringing the proposed review mechanism back to you in due course in the form of regulations, draft regulations, which would be subject to public consultation as well. Another issue that was raised in the consultation was the absence of any provision in our current retention framework relating to the material of deceased persons. So we've taken the view that there would be merit in retaining material after the death of a subject, but it would only be reasonable to do so for a time-limited period. We've taken a look at practice across other European countries and now intend that all biometric material should be deleted 10 years after the death of a subject, or the maximum retention period, whichever is shorter. We've also looked again at the issue of cases left on books, since it was drawn to our attention that some of those cases could involve relatively serious charges. So we're now proposing there should be a 3-year retention period for cases involving qualifying offences, which are more serious offences, and 12 months for all other cases. Another change that we're minded to make to the original policy proposals relates to the retention of material on the basis of an overseas conviction. Our initial proposal was to retain that material for 50 or 25 years based on whether the conviction related to an adult or someone under 18. And this was primarily due to difficulties with mapping offences committed abroad across to equivalent Northern Ireland offences. But following further discussions with the PSNI, they have undertaken to revise their operational policy and are now aiming to map those offences against relevant maximum retention bans. So that would in effect allow us to apply the same model, the 75-50-25 model, to overseas convictions and maintain consistency with the proposed maximum retention periods for UK convictions. There's one final policy change that I'd like to highlight, and that relates to the scope of the role of the Northern Ireland Commissioner for Biometric Retention. The consultation showed strong support for a commissioner, given that that would add transparency and independence to the oversight of biometrics. And our initial proposal was to extend the commissioner's role to include keeping under review the operation of the retention framework once it's commenced. We now plan to add two further things to the Commissioner's remit. Firstly, keeping under review the operation of the scheduled review process. And secondly, considering applications made by the Chief Constable to retain material associated with deceased persons beyond the 10-year period that we've proposed, but that would only be where exceptional circumstances apply. So just in conclusion, the use of biometric data by law enforcement bodies is obviously a valuable investigative tool in the prevention and detection of crime, but we do acknowledge that retaining that data also engages significant civil liberty and privacy concerns. So what we've sought to do is to strike a fair and proportionate balance between these two competing demands, and subject to the views of the committee, it would be our intention to seek their inclusion within the forthcoming Justice Miscellaneous Provisions Bill. So thank you, and happy as ever to take any questions.
Okay, thank you, Maura. Can I just ask, the 75, 50, 25 year model, is that the same in other jurisdictions across the United Kingdom?
We've looked at a number of jurisdictions, including other parts of the UK. Actually, our starting point was that at the moment, following, you will recall the Sinead and Mason
review of criminal records, which concluded that criminal record information should be kept until the subject reaches the age of 100. So we started from that and then mapped across to other areas. I think in England they're still considering the outcome of the Gochran judgment. So
focus more on Brexit at the moment than actually.
Yeah, so
any policy, but they haven't defined that policy yet.
They haven't, so we're actually slightly further ahead in our thinking, I think it's fair to say, and we thought it was better to move ahead rather than awaiting what they would put in place, although I think they were looking at something akin to what we were thinking of in terms of a review mechanism.
Yeah.
So, yeah, as I say, we've looked at UK and we looked at some other European countries. For instance, Estonia, Finland, Greece, Luxembourg, they hold all material until an offender has passed away. And they factor in various timelines for retention after death. Slovakia and Latvia hold material for at least 75 years. Denmark holds material until the offender reaches the age of 80. So while 75 years sounds like quite a long period of time, I don't think it's significantly out of kilter with what we've seen in the other jurisdictions that we've looked at. And I would emphasise as well that it's a maximum period, so when you overlay it with the review mechanism, it doesn't necessarily mean that all material would be held for that length of time.
Yes, yes. So the review mechanism, you know, could shorten the period in which people are having to have their material held. For what it's worth, I prefer the indefinite ruling. That's my own preference for all categories. But nevertheless, the European Court has decided otherwise. Is there a mechanism whereby it would be reasonable to have it until somebody dies? So you take the 25-year model, for example. I understand this proportionate argument, but you know, would it be proportionate just to say that it's there for the period in which that you're at?
I think, Chair, in terms of proportionality, Maura outlined some of the higher periods in other European countries. Some other European countries have much lower retention periods, 50 years or below. We did look at a number of options, and we did consider the possibility of retaining material until the subject dies. But there's only, I think, 4 countries out of 27 who actually have currently a policy of retention until death. So it would be slightly out of kilter.
Okay, now I appreciate you're trying to get something that will comply with the court ruling, so I'm not going to revisit the arguments around this because it is what it is and you're trying to get something that complies with the law. So what's your time frame for implementation then? Is through the miscellaneous bill?
Yes, we're hopeful at this point of the proposals being able to be included in the miscellaneous provisions bill. There's no absolute guarantee, but we are hopeful that that would be the case. So that would mean, I understand that the bill is likely to be introduced early next year to the Assembly. So there would be a considerable time frame involved before these provisions would be commenced. Commencement orders would be required for all of these provisions. So that would be, you'd be looking at potentially late 2022.
And are you confident that this time it'll stand up to any court challenge? Because I can recall the previous committee supporting the changes, which have subsequently now been overruled again.
The Gochran judgment did really set out three main principles. The first was to do away with completely indefinite retention. The second was to take into consideration the seriousness of the offence. The third was to have a meaningful review process. We believe that these proposals, as revised, include those three elements.
I think there's always a risk of challenge. Whether or not it would be a successful challenge, I think, would be mitigated by us having evidence that we are moving towards ensuring compliance. So if we have a process in place that should lead to a proportionate package of measures, I think it would be something that certainly we would draw upon to defend any challenge that was taken.
Okay, is there any members want to raise questions on this one? Gordon Dunn.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for the presentation. just how are they recorded, the fingerprints?
They're on a national fingerprints database. It's called Ident1. The Northern Ireland collection is contained within that national database along with the rest of the UK fingerprints. Fingerprints in the olden days were taken by ink and pad, you know, but now obviously they're taken electronically and migrated to the national systems.
So how are they managed then? How do you see the review taking place? Obviously the frequency of review would be important. And how is that processed? And who would be doing that?
We are at the developmental stage of our proposals in relation to the review mechanism. The details aren't part of this, aren't part of the provisions that need to be contained within the miscellaneous provisions bill. But nevertheless, it's important to understand where we're, the direction of travel of the department on these issues. The review mechanism is designed we're looking at two possible options for the review mechanism. One would be review periods which reflect the maximum retention periods, as we've set out, the 75, 50, 25.
Yeah.
Another option might be to align it with the length of sentence set by the judge in court, set out review periods in relation to that length of sentence. So we've had some initial thoughts in relation to what those review periods should look like, and we were thinking in terms of 20 to 30 year review period for the most serious crimes in the qualifying offences bracket, and shorter periods of review, perhaps 10 year reviews for those that are within the more minor offences. We're envisaging that would be an automatic review. It would be for the PSNI to carry out the review in the first instance, although we envisage also the Biometrics Commissioner having a role in reviewing the review process.
Okay, so it's going to be an ongoing process. And will there be a policy as such, say, on the retention process?
In relation to the review,
But we looked recently at a PSNA retention policy, you know, and it's very clear all the specific years that were laid out there. So what I'm saying is, where will this fit in then, an overall policy?
I think at the moment we have indefinite retention. Once we created the maximum retention periods, what we're thinking of is an automated system, because that would minimise the resource requirement on the police. So once material reaches that point, there would be an automatic deletion of the material. So then overlaid with that, as we said earlier, there would be this new review process where at a certain point, and we're still looking at what exactly the trigger would be to initiate that review. And William touched on a couple of options, and we may identify others as we're working through this. But at that point, the review would be undertaken and a decision would be taken based on a range of factors, and a bit similar to the types of factors that were considered in the court. I would imagine it would look at things like the seriousness of the offence, the age of the offender when the offence occurred, whether there have been further offences since, whether there's anything to suggest that there's a public protection risk, particularly to children or vulnerable adults. And then once all of those factors have been taken into account, a decision made whether to retain that record or to have it deleted at that point. But that would be a more manual process, but we're trying to strike a balance here between manual processing and automation where that's possible. But I don't think we could just go straight to an automated process, because that would be a bit too one size fits all, and we couldn't demonstrate proportionality on that basis.
Okay.
So I just want to check we've answered the question that you were asking.
Yeah, that's fine. Thanks, Chair.
Right, Doug Beattie.
Thanks, Chair. Thank you for that. I mean, it's fascinating stuff. Can I just ask, if the legislation was to come in tomorrow, What's the starting point? Are we saying the starting point would be tomorrow, or are we saying the starting point would be 75 years ago? In other words, would there be tomorrow a complete cull of records 75 years back?
Well, obviously this isn't coming in anytime very soon, but if we're looking at 2022-2023 as a starting point, yes, it would be. It would relate to all data. So, for example, commencing the Criminal Justice Act, as Maura outlined, at that point would mean, for example, I think it's 30,000 records, DNA sample records, and 80,000 fingerprint records relating to non-conviction would be subject to deletion. So yes, there would be the deletion of a significant number of records. That represents less than 10% of the total number of records on the database, I have to say, but nevertheless, it's a significant number.
Yes, and I think I know what you mean, but maybe I didn't explain myself properly, but if I'm looking at the 75, 50, 25, whenever it's brought in, the point I'm making is, do you then go back the 25 years and then cut them from there, or is that the starting point, so we're going to hold it for the next 50 years, or the next 25, or the next 70 years? Is it...
No, it'll be the date in which the material was actually taken in the first instance. So you'll work your 75, 50, 25 from that point, you know. So, for example, if some material was taken 10 years ago and they fell within the 25-year band, then it would come up for destruction 15 years' time then.
Oh, no, okay. So here's another one. What about non-convictions? How long are we allowed to hold DNA if there's no conviction?
Well, basically until we change the legislation. The current legislation allows for that material relating to non-convictions to be retained.
Yeah.
And that's in breach of the European Court judgment. So whenever we commence the CGAA, that will be the point at which non-convicted material can be deleted.
Okay, so I'm looking at this as if this legislation is going through. So I'm imagining this legislation has just been approved. The point I'm making, when this legislation is approved, how long are we allowed to hold DNA if there's not going to be a conviction, or there hasn't been a conviction? How long?
If the legislation comes into play and is commenced, the CJA, In the majority of cases, non-convicted material would be destroyed if there was no other legal basis to retain it. For example, if there was a previous conviction on that individual, then obviously that would allow the material to be retained for a period of time. For a person who has been had their material taken, no previous convictions, and has not been convicted for the offence in which the material was taken, that material would be destroyed.
All right, so a hypothetical case. Well, it's not hypothetical, it's a real case. So, Lisa Dorian, they haven't got anybody for her murder. Does that mean when this legislation comes in, any DNA they may have taken, which hasn't been evidentially secured for a conviction, would have to be destroyed?
The Chief Constable, I believe under the provisions yet to be commenced, the Chief Constable would have the possibility of applying to the Biometrics Commissioner in relation to circumstances which they believed that material needed to be kept for, and that they would set out in an order. That there would be a very specific protocol for this, but that would be set out in an order before the Assembly in terms of the prescribed circumstances that the Chief Constable believes exist in relation to that particular piece of material. So there is the possibility of exceptional cases being where material could be kept, but they would be very exceptional cases and subject to strict protocols.
Yeah, I get that, and thank you. And the more I dig into this, the more we responded to this, and actually we're very supportive of it. So don't think I'm just trying to dig into you for no reason here. I'm just a few things that popped into my mind. And if we're destroying all DNA when there's no conviction, what happens when there's an association further down the line if we have no DNA to cross-reference? You know, the more you dig into it, the more we're losing an intelligence biometric database which can help get convictions, and it does leave me slightly concerned, as does the rules around the deceased leaves me slightly concerned. Can I just ask something? I haven't ever heard of this before, and that doesn't... Do we have a biometrics commissioner already?
No, we don't. We have a UK commissioner who has a specific role in Northern Ireland in relation to national security determinations, but there is provision in the 2013 Act, the Northern Ireland Act, for the establishment or appointment of a Northern Ireland commissioner, but that would be an appointment would have to take place once we're in position to commence the legislation.
So we'll have a biometrics commissioner looking after the interests of the perpetrators and their DNA, and we still don't have a victims commissioner. Thank you.
Sorry, I wouldn't characterise the role quite that way. I think the role of the biometrics commissioner is really to oversee the operation of the regime for the retention of material, and in some cases it may be that, as William just outlined, a commissioner might rule that material that would normally fall due for deletion could be retained. So I think it's I would characterise it as a more neutral role than maybe you had thought there.
Fair point. Thank you, Chair.
Linda Dillon.
I was actually going to make the point more just now, because and also if people have not been convicted, we can't assume they're perpetrators. So we have to look at the balance of this. But I accept. I actually think it was a good point you made around Lisa Dorian's case, and I wouldn't have thought of it. I think it's good that we had this conversation and got that out there. Can I just ask, in terms of, and I know you have obviously made extensive changes and. They appear to be positive changes, but what is the Human Rights Commissioner's view, or the Human Rights Commission's view of this now with the amendments and changes that you have made, Maura?
We have engaged with the Commissioner. William, do you want to say a bit about?
Yes, indeed. The Human Rights Commission did respond to the consultation, and they had some concerns, particularly about compliance with the court judgment, particularly around the 80-year retention ban period that we had proposed, and the volume of offences that would be contained within that 50-year period. I've engaged with the Human Rights Commission since the consultation, along with the PSNI and other key stakeholders, the Commission, I don't want to speak for the Commission, but it's clear that they see the revised proposals, and we have essentially, as Maura has outlined in the opening remarks, there's a total of five significant revised proposals, but one of them relates to the 50-year maximum retention band. Originally, we had considered that all adult convictions outside of qualifying offences, in other words, outside of the very most serious, should be contained within the 50-year band. But we have now revised that proposal to take out those adult convictions for recordable offences that do not result in a custodial sentence. And that would remove around about three quarters of the records from the 50-year band and put it into the 25-year band. When I explained that to the Human Rights Commissioner, to the Commission, they indicated that they felt that it was a very significant improvement on the original proposals. Although I cannot speak for the Commission, obviously, I would. In the discussions that I've had with them and with others, I certainly believe that the revised proposals would comply fully with the government judgment.
We've also, since the consultation, been briefing the Commission on what sorts of options we're looking at in relation to a review mechanism. And I can understand why some people were sort of nervous in signing off on this without knowing what that looked like, but for us to have set that out in detail now would have preempted the committee and the Assembly's consideration of the proposals that we're currently developing, so we didn't feel we could do that. But I think the fact that we're now starting to engage with stakeholders on that detail and granularity, I think, has given them some assurance as well on the issue of proportionality. So I think that the further discussions we've had with the likes of the Human Rights Commission has, I think, brought us to the view that we'd be in a pretty good position to demonstrate and evidence that what we have done in terms of the balance we're trying to strike here would meet the requirements that have been set down by the European Court. But I think we'll continue to engage with them. We also plan to engage further with the Information Commissioner's Office. They've been keen to talk to us further as well on matters such as how the role of the Biometrics Commissioner would sit alongside the Information Commissioner's role. So I think that was a good point for them to have raised, and I'm keen to engage with them further in that to ensure that those roles are complementary.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Could we write to the Human Rights Commissioner and ask for a view?
Yep, we could. Okay. Rachel,
thanks very much.
Rachel Woods, thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, Linda, that was my question as well, in terms of the Human Rights Commission and these newer proposals. So I fully support writing on behalf of the committee to the Human Rights Commission and see what their sort of updated opinion is. Just in terms of you said you've been engaging with the PSNI, the Human Rights Commission and others on the newer proposals. Who are the others?
We are engaged, those are the main two, frankly, that we have engaged with.
Sorry, I may have missed
that. Those are the main two that we've engaged with, but we have given progress reports to, for example, the policing board and so on. But really, those are the main two that we've engaged with.
Okay, thank you. And just in terms of the 10 years after a person has died, and then the proposal were to retain that, or the original retention period, is this based on any empirical evidence in terms of, you know, operational matters, or is that based on what other European countries do?
I think, to be fair, it's mainly based upon what other European countries do. We've had a look at the regimes right across Europe, and they seem to fall into categories of either 20 years after death, upon death. There were four countries that Maura outlined in the initial remarks that indicated that four countries delete at death. Other countries delete 20 years after, many delete 10 years after, and some delete 5 years after. So it seems like a reasonable balance, 10 years. We've also discussed this with the police. In principle, they're supportive.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Sinead Bradley is joining us for this session too.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, a few points. Yeah, I did get clarity on some of them. So it is from the acquisition date that the timeline runs through. But I just wanted to get absolute clarity. The data that's held, the biometric information that's held, there's two types. There's the person who knowingly has provided that information, and that's very clear. And as Doug referred to, then there's the other type where it's evidence that's gathered at a crime scene where the person may not actually be identified. And are those both sets of data treated the same way? Do they both have the same weight of human rights compliancy around them? And on the third point then, I just wondered then, I did say on that 2.24, the department could, with the statutory role of the Biometric Commissioner, consider further retention of material in exceptional circumstances. Now, I imagine that legacy issues would rest heavily on that. But I do wonder, would there be, not that I have any strong objection to it, please don't get me wrong here, but is there the possibility of this being a backdoor to indefinite retention, and would that therefore possibly then be challengeable?
Well, maybe I can just cover your first point in relation to crime scene material. Crime scene material won't fall within these destruction regime. It'll be purely material taken from a suspect in relation to an arrest for a recordable offence. So crime scene material will remain on the database until such times it's no longer required, or it'll be there for any subsequent matches that may occur, you know, kind of, but you can be reassured that crime scene material will not be destroyed. In relation to exceptional circumstances, I think the intention is that it will be exceptional circumstances that the biometric commissioner's role would only be engaged, you know, for particular cases where the police may have a particular operational reason why they would want to retain that material. I mean, the chief constable would have to make an application to the commissioner to set out what them exceptional circumstances are. You know, one of the members also mentioned about Lisa Dorian. I mean, that might be a particular situation where, you know, somebody who perhaps has died and was a strong suspect in that case, you know, that it may be that material would be retained on exceptional circumstances.
Yeah, thank you. Have you any view on legacy issues, whether they would be able to come in under that?
Just on legacy, I think that's slightly separate issue in that, well, we had hoped that by now there would have been legislative provision in the form of Schedule 8 of the Stormont House Agreement Bill, which would have put in place a mechanism for the retention of legacy material for the Historical Investigations Unit. But as I mentioned earlier, that's been overtaken by events. So originally we had the 2013 Act, as we talked about earlier, and we had been ready to commence that. At that time, that was just looking at the deletion of material related to non-convicted persons. But it was the Chief Constable at the time, George Hamilton, who raised a concern that if we were to proceed with that, some of that material could potentially be of interest to legacy investigations, and that's the reason we didn't move to commence that legislation at that time. So since then, I don't think in 2015 we thought 5 years later we would still be in the position we're in. We had anticipated that within a shorter period than that there would have been a legislative solution put in place that would have allowed for the retention of any material that could be relevant to legacy investigations, with obviously strict controls around that, so you wouldn't have the police dipping into that for modern day investigations. The access to that would have been reserved to the Historical Investigations Unit. So on legacy, I think we're still awaiting developments, and we're just going to have to see what comes from any political discussions there are around the Secretary of State's latest set of proposals. We don't yet have an indication of a time frame for that, but it is very much a political matter at this stage, I think, and we're just waiting to see what the developments around that are.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just ask, for the non-convicted material, have the department got that broken down into, you know, what is deemed legacy-related material versus other types of crimes?
No, not on that level of detail, Chair. I mean, in many respects, existing material would be classed as legacy material. Obviously, when this legislation at some stage commences, new material taken after the date of commencement will obviously be not legacy material, it would be new material. So in terms of retaining legacy material per se, it will be material at a point before this legislation actually commences then.
Okay, so there'll be a protocol established for non-convicted material whereby the Chief Constable can make a case to say this needs to be retained for the potential of future use. But how do you know what material that you need to keep? Who's going to go through all of the different types of material to assess whether or not that needs to be kept?
Well, what we'd be talking about here would be that under this legislation, as William has mentioned, there's going to be a volume of material, DNA and fingerprints, that will, quite a large amount of material would have to be destroyed under the new destruction regime that this legislation would introduce. The idea is that before any destruction takes place, the police would take what we would call a snapshot of the actual entire database at the point before deletion, and that snapshot would be used by the Historical Investigations Unit for the purposes of legacy investigations. That would allow the PSNI then to hit the button on deletions. So effectively, the snapshot would contain material that currently exists on the database at the moment, at any particular point in time, and before the actual legislation is commenced.
And so the provision in relation to this, Chief Constable having the ability to go and make the case on an exceptional basis to the Biometrics Commissioner, I think that's intended to deal more with individual cases as opposed to dealing with an entire batch of information. So as Gary says, there will need to be some sort of solution put in place to deal with material that could be potentially relevant to legacy cases in the future.
Just to tease this out further, I want to come back to that issue, but is there no way in which we can put a legal framework in place that stops the destruction of non-convicted material? That has been ruled against in the courts.
That was the Marper judgment, the original judgment that prompted the creation of the 2013 legislation.
That's correct. I mean, obviously the 2013 Act introduced the corrective measures in response to the Marper judgment, which dealt with non-convicted persons. I know, obviously, we've got the Gotland judgment, which deals with convicted persons, you know. So I think we are where we are on this. I mean, I don't think there's any way around it, you know, kind of. We have to proceed with this legislation.
Going back then to how the PSNI would determine what material to retain, why would they be able to retain troubles-related material but not offences then, or potential material that relates to things that aren't associated with the troubles?
I think the idea was the snapshot would be taken prior to the deletion, but that snapshot wouldn't be retained by the PSNI, it would be retained by whichever body is established to deal with the investigation of legacy matters. But I think the issue at the moment is we just don't have clarity yet on what that revised set of arrangements for dealing with the legacy of the past might be, which is making it difficult for us to predict when we would be in a position to move ahead, because our current position and our position since 2013 has been that there would need to be some sort of provision for the retention of material in some way before we could move ahead with the deletion of material.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, sure. I think just to be absolutely clear, when you say you're talking about the deletion of or retaining non-convicted material, what would actually happen here is that once the new legislation was commenced and a snapshot had been taken before that happened, the snapshot would be used purely for legacy purposes, but the actual PSNI databases would be cleansed of the material that would fall for destruction under the new legislation. So there would be no speculative search of that material going forward. I think that's the difference, you know. So that's the reason why we need some kind of legal basis to create a snapshot, so that in law that would be lawfully retained for the sole purpose of legacy investigations.
Okay. I know I'm revisiting a court ruling back in 2013, and we had this discussion back then, and this is about how we manage convicted material as opposed to going back over the non-convicted issue that we dealt with a number of years ago. So just trying to get my head around the HIU legacy type issue. So Linda Dillon and Rachel Woods, just want to follow up on that. Linda?
I was just actually going to, because the conversation was getting a wee bit confusing for me, and I was just going to clarify, and it is clarified for me now, if the HIU is set up, they are the legal basis under which the material can be retained. It can't be retained on PSNA database. So you will be complying then with the European judgment. So that's the legal judgment.
The legislation is created that would empower the HIU to hold that material, and that's what we're missing.
Yeah.
Yep. So it would have been put in place under the HIU.
Rachel?
Just to clarify, what's a snapshot? Or is it a condensing of information? Do you know what that is? Because I know we're saying it a lot, but I don't know what that is we're talking about.
Are these really a copy?
Yeah, I mean, sorry, maybe it's maybe misleading. We've been referring to it as a snapshot, you know, kind of in our working papers and whatever, but it is effectively a copy of the material that's currently held on the database, and an electronic copy that would obviously then be passed to the HIU once there was a legal basis for that to be passed and or created and passed to them then.
Just so it's a direct copy of what we have at the moment, to be used for the purposes of legacy if and when HIU is set up, and that would mean that there wouldn't be there wouldn't be open to legal challenge, because that would be having information held indefinitely.
Well, it would be held for the duration of the HIU or legacy commission or whatever kind of body it is, which is due to be a time limited entity, so it wouldn't be an indefinite retention. It would be for however long is needed for the investigation of the outstanding cases.
Well, so I suppose I'm asking the question, when is retention not retention, and when is destruction not destruction? We simply take a screenshot of things. That's what it sounds like.
Well, yeah, it's obviously a screenshot purely for the purposes of legacy. I explained that, you know, that the actual going forward, that material will not exist on the national databases, you know, so it would only be used for the purposes of the unsolved cases in relation to the troubles, you know, kind of, once the investigations are over, then that material or that copy of the material would be destroyed.
I'm not casting a decision one way or the other with regards to the positive or negatives of that, but does that not clearly and surely create a two-tiered evidential base for unsolved crimes?
So in terms of the legislative basis, that doesn't exist at the moment. It was due to be created through the Stormont House Agreement Bill, but that has not been taken forward, as you know, and the revised proposals that the Secretary of State published are significantly different from the arrangements that the Stormont House Agreement Bill was to give effect to. So I think the legislation that would if there was political agreement on the fresh set of proposals, I think the legislation would look quite different overall, but there would probably be a schedule similar to Schedule 8 in the current draft bill that would create a legal basis on which material could be held solely for legacy purposes.
So it would be
a sort of a parallel system, but as Gary says, the material would be gone from police databases, and so would the sharing that normally takes place of criminal record information between different systems. So not just access to data within Northern Ireland.
So it could well sit in a enforcement body or a police force that's not actually as accountable as the PSNI in that regard?
Well, it would sit with whatever body is agreed will take carriage of legacy investigations, and I think for such an entity to exist, there would be a requirement for there to have been political agreement on the shape of that.
So if that political agreement doesn't come before your miscellaneous bill,
yes,
where do we sit?
We would be in the position that we've been in since 2013 with the 2013 Criminal Justice Act, where we've had to pause commencement of that pending some mechanism that would allow for legacy investigations. I think at the moment the position is that we're awaiting further political developments on dealing with the legacy of the past. If a clear decision were ever taken that there was not going to be legislation that would create that kind of framework, then we may have to look again at what would need to be done to allow us to implement the legislation, because I don't think the European Court would see us as being compliant if we were just going to leave that legislation commenced indefinitely, back to the indefinitely word.
So,
what that plan B might look like, I couldn't say at this point in time. We would have to look for some other mechanism of retaining the material. We'd also have to think about where that material should be held.
So would this change the vehicle of legislative change here with regards to the miscellaneous bill? Would you not place it in the miscellaneous bill? Or is that something you're going to do irrespective of a political agreement?
I think our plan would be to place it in the miscellaneous bill. The provisions that were the revised provisions that we're talking about in relation to biometrics in the bill.
But not commence
those provisions until other elements were in line.
But we're not intending to include within that bill provision for the taking of a snapshot or copy of the existing database.
Why not? And then how are you doing that?
It's the Northern Ireland office who were to make provision for the retention of the data for the purposes of legacy investigations, given that that's the department that's been leading on policy on dealing with the past.
And how will the NIE do that legally?
Sorry, I didn't understand that question. Sorry.
How will the NIO take the snapshot legally?
Well, as Maura said, the NIO would be responsible for any statutory provision that needs to be put in place to provide the legal basis for the creation and the retention of that snapshot. It was intended that provision would be in the Stormont House Agreement Bill, and that's what we are reliant on in terms of that separate provision that would allow for the snapshot to be taken. That would allow us then to proceed with our legislation as such. If we don't have that provision, then as Mar said, we obviously there's a point in time in which we'll have to decide whether what the plan B is or what other options there are.
And what time scale are you working off in that point of time?
Well, at the moment, obviously these new proposals have to be legislated for. The idea would be to put them in the miscellaneous provisions bill. The time, obviously, there's going to be, I think they're, the hope to get that bill through before the current mandate, you know. So it's at that point where we'll have to decide whether, if there isn't a snapshot provision in place, then we obviously have to look at other means in which we can proceed. For example, it may be a transitional provision that needs to be put in place, or some form of interim kind of holding position that we can proceed with the legislation, but also try and preserve the material that would fall for destruction for legacy purposes.
And that, but I think at this point, time for us to seek to do that would be seen as directly cutting across any political decisions that might be taken.
I understand. But that power itself, who would retain that power? Would that power then be given in the miscellaneous bill? And that, would that be the Justice Minister that would hold and retain that power?
So you're talking about the retention of the material for legacy investigations?
Yep.
No, we're not proposing to make any provision in the miscellaneous provisions bill for that.
So who then decides on the point of time?
It's a bit of a chicken and egg thing, really, in terms of that we... I mean, obviously we're reliant on the provision being made by the NIO for the legal basis for the snapshot. And obviously we have to push ahead with this particular, these provisions in relation to the CJA. So it's a very difficult question to answer at the present time. We need political agreement on legacy to move forward with the snapshot provision, and it would be very, very difficult for us to give a timeline in terms of when we would be in a position to commence the CJA legislation.
Okay, thank you very much, Chair.
Can I make a suggestion, Chair, that we write to the NAO and ask them the questions, because they're the people responsible for this, not the people sitting at that table, to be fair to them. And I think they're in an impossible situation. And how could they possibly answer questions that are for the NAO to answer? And we should have had the legacy mechanisms, and that's through no fault of anybody sitting at that table. In fact, it's more likely to be between the NAO and the people around this table. So I don't think we should be, I suppose, putting people under pressure to answer questions that it is absolutely not their responsibility or capability to answer, in fairness to them. But I do think we should write to the NAO and ask how they're going to address this issue.
Yeah, happy to do that. And I suppose the other point I'm just going to make, this is being taken forward through the Miscellaneous Provisions Bill. There are aspects of this that I'm not happy with, but I'm happy to note, because that's what we're being asked to do, that their next steps is to do it in the Miscellaneous Provisions Bill. I will want to look at how the 25 years, I don't think that's enough, but that's by the way. There'll be a future point where we need to look at the actual legislation and try and determine our positions at that stage, and I don't suggest prolonging this session any longer on that basis. That we note the consultation response, we note the ways forward, and we follow up with correspondence to the Human Rights Commission to get an updated opinion from them, and we raise the issues around legacy and the points that members have raised with the Northern Ireland office. If members are content with that, I'm looking at the screen, and Sinead, I see you've your hand up. I'm not sure if that's from a previous occasion, but I'll just bring you in.
Yes, Chair, it has been pretty much covered, so I won't go over it. It was about that timeline. The pause discussion went in quite depth too, because it is, you know, we need to be really careful about the timeline here. We can't allow any slippage where valuable information could be lost. So yes, the proposal to contact the NIO, I think, is the right one. But I still go back to that provision 2.24, whether there's room for amendment in there, where we can see that, you know, it talks about a commissioner and the role of a commissioner and retention. But I'm wondering, is there still room to work in there somehow the possibility of including the Secretary of State or the NIO in some form to have a right under this? So if it did go through the miscellaneous provision, that it's sort of encaptured in some form. regardless of what the NIO then continue to do, just as a safeguard.
Mara?
So can you just clarify the question? Is it that you're suggesting that provision in the...
Yeah, you did mention that 2.24 was for a specific case where you'd be talking about, you know, you could live under exceptional circumstances for the retention by the Chief Constable. And I just wondered, sort of in that, you know, I suppose it's in that provision or that recommendation that the conversation opened about what could be considered, and you did say that was an individual case, but is there still room and time to put in there something that would be broader and that would allow NIO involvement or some level of involvement to allow the miscellaneous provision bill to go forward and maybe have scope that the NIO could use to retain? I'm just conscious of the two timelines here and the need to run everything parallel.
I see the point, and I see what you're trying to achieve there, to sort of have a kind of almost a safety net in case there's sort of nothing coming over the hill in terms of a solution and legacy. I think it would be difficult maybe to put that within the purview of the Biometrics Commissioner. It would be quite a significant change to the role that's currently envisaged for them. And I think before we would even countenance that, we would want to be satisfied that there was going to be broad political support for a change of that significance. I'm not sure necessarily that there would be. There's also the appropriateness of us taking on a responsibility that currently sits with the UK government. So I think there's some quite significant issues there that we would need to work through, and obviously we would need to take the views of our own minister. And I appreciate what you're suggesting here is an attempt to be pragmatic and to find us a way through, because as it was recognised there, we find ourselves in this difficult position where we're trying to achieve a result without necessarily having control over the levers that we need to achieve it. I think it would be difficult for us today to say that would necessarily give us the way through in the way that you're suggesting. I think it would be quite a departure, and I think it could be difficult to get a political agreement that would be the way this should be done, given that we're touching on a hugely sensitive and emotive issue around the legacy of the past, where I don't need to tell the committee how many differing views there are on what should be done there. But I appreciate the suggestion and the spirit in which it was offered.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Moira, can I thank you very much and your team for coming to the committee today? I'm sure we'll talk about this in the future. Okay, members, thank you. So we'll write to the Human Rights Commission and also the NIO, and we'll note the consultation response and the department's proposed next steps. Okay, so the next item is to go through the Domestic Abuse and Family Proceedings Bill. I'm going to take a short comfort break and we'll reconvene at 4:10. The executive summary has just been handed out to members because I know the committee has been incredibly hard to get this so we can approve it today. So if members want to just have a very quick perusal of that, then we'll reconvene at 4:10 to go through it. Okay, members.
Sorry. I had two tiny wee things.
Okay.
Right, so in part one of the report. That's a lie. Part two, sorry. The Domestic Abuse Commissioner.
Yes.
States that the committee were supportive of the calls for appointment. I think we're sympathetic to it. I wasn't decided whether it was the right thing or not the right thing, and I kind of thought that's where it was left, to be honest with you. I would prefer if that said sympathetic to the calls.
Sorry, I can't. Linda, what paragraph are you?
Sorry. So it's page 22, paragraph 31.
Paragraph 21.
Yeah. It's not a big thing.
I don't have page numbers in my copy.
No, nor do I.
So that's why I'm wondering.
It's under the under Mr. Abuse Commissioner. 31.
Is it in the
report part two?
Part two, right, I'm sorry. Aye, because they've all been renumbered. Hold on. Okay, and sorry, what was what I've got renumbered one, so what was the heading?
The domestic
abuse question.
Committee. So is that the committee is supportive of the calls for appointment of a domestic abuse commissioner? I would be more inclined to say sympathetic too.
So would you like to change it to sympathetic?
I would, if the committee are agreeable. Probably not.
It's a bit weaker, isn't it, saying that, though?
Hmm?
It's a lesser statement.
It is, and that's my point. It is intended to be a lesser statement because I didn't believe that we had agreed that we were supportive of the domestic abuse commissioner specifically. Actually, what we discussed is that the recommendations that come out of the amendment that we put in would potentially recommend for a domestic abuse commissioner, and if it does, absolutely, that's where the recommendation should come from. And that was, in my view, the kind of where we come down to. I'm not supportive of it.
Yeah.
To be fair, but that's why we very specifically said it would be important that the recommendations of that, those recommendations are important because they could potentially say, actually, a domestic abuse commissioner needs to take on these responsibilities.
Okay, I'm happy to change it to sympathetic, if members are. I just think it still conveys a positive consideration of the issue, and then we reached a view based on the advice around going for ultimately what we have decided to go to. So where it relates in the report to the Domestic Abuse Commissioner, we'll amend that to read sympathetic as a supportive of.
And one other tiny thing, and again, it's, I think I'm being pedantic after me saying it, I just wouldn't be getting speaking to 1 o'clock in the morning. On the paid special leave, paragraph 50. It states, and I don't actually have it in front of me here, but it states that content.
Sorry.
That we're content that the minister is taking that forward. I'm certainly not content that, because I don't think we have any anything concrete to say that it is, but I think we should be calling on the minister.
What paragraph, sorry, Linda?
Paragraph 50.
The committee is supportive of.
Second report, yeah. So I think it says that the committee are content that the minister is going to take that issue forward, but I'm not content.
Is this under
611?
Yeah, okay.
Special leave.
Committee is supportive of this initiative and welcomes the commitment from the minister.
So
that's what it says. Am I in the same paragraph?
Doesn't say content.
Sorry, but welcomes the commitment. But is there a commitment? Because I'm not sure that there is a commitment. I wasn't welcoming a commitment. I was actually calling on the minister to give a commitment.
All right, it's just from paragraph 609. Minister Dawes has advised that if there is a consensus that legislative provision is required, then her department will identify a suitable legislative vehicle. So, okay. If you look, you haven't.
Well, that's fair enough. If it's an absolute commitment from the minister, I don't want to fail on. But if there's a commitment there, I wasn't sure there was to be.
You could always speak to the report in the chamber to try and get a commitment.
Yeah, no, that's fair enough.
Get on right.
I think what the minister had said was if the review showed that a change was needed, she would identify a suitable legislative vehicle at that time.
And I'm going to say this, anybody would have struggled to find anything wrong with that report. It was excellent, worst class. And I know how much work was put into it, but appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay. Christine, can I just check then on the domestic abuse change?
Yeah.
Where that trying to identify where that relates to in the actual formal questions. Okay, well, I think that's it, and we can go through this formally now. Okay, members, format for the formal agreement then of the report. If I can refer members to the title page, committee membership and powers, table of contents and list of abbreviations, pages of the report, and formally put the question. Are members content that the title page, committee membership and powers, table of contents and list of abbreviations pages stand part of the report?
Content.
Agreed.
The introduction section, members, I can refer you to paragraphs 1 to 22. And I'll put the question, if members are content that the introduction section of paragraphs 1 to 22 stand part of the report.
Agreed.
Agreed, yeah.
Consideration of the bill provision section, paragraphs 23 to 522. Are members content that the consideration of the bill provision section at paragraphs 23 to 522 stand part of the report?
Agreed, yeah.
And if I can refer members now to the implementation of the legislation section of the report, which is paragraphs 523 to 561. Are members content that the implementation of the legislation section of the report at paragraphs 523 to 561 stand part of the report?
Agreed.
Other issues that aren't covered in the bill, this is sections paragraph 562 through to 654, and just to accommodate then the amendment that has been made from Linda, if members are content that the other issues not covered in the bill section at paragraphs 562 to 591, first of all, stand part of the report.
Agreed.
592 then is the proposed amendment. If members are content then that we agree that amendment to the Domestic Abuse Commissioner from support to sympathy.
Agreed.
And then if members are content, and Christine, is that paragraphs 543 to
655? 593.
593,
yeah.
Sorry.
655.
593 then through to 655 stand part of the report. Clause by clause, scrutiny then of the bill. Paragraphs 655 to 703. If members are content that the clause by clause scrutiny of the bill section of the report stand part of the report.
Agreed.
Yeah.
And appendices, if are members content that the appendices stand part of the report?
Agreed.
Agreed.
Executive summary.
Agreed.
Yep.
Are members content that the executive summary stands part of the report?
Agreed.
Agreed. Now, members, if we can agree for the report to be published on the committee's web page and issued to all MLAs.
Agreed.
Yep.
And members, if you can agree that I'll clear the draft minutes of today's meeting, and that will be then included in Appendix 6, and this will enable the report then to be finalised, and the draft minutes will be replaced by the final version of the minutes, which will be agreed then by this committee.
Agreed.
Members agreed. And then, members, if you're content, we'll issue an electronic copy of the bill report to all organisations and individuals that provided evidence to the committee on the bill.
Agreed. Yeah.
Okay, members, and then just to inform you that any typographical or formatting errors, of which I didn't identify any, but they'll be checked and that'll be amended to the report at the proofing stage before that is circulated to MLAs and published on the committee web page. Okay?
Agreed.
Okay, well then, members, I know I thanked the staff last week in terms of the work or the previous week around this, but it was a mammoth amount of work, even in the last 2 weeks, to get the report through to members. So, again, I really do appreciate the work that the committee staff have put into this and the assistance that they have provided to all members in getting us to this stage. And I shall say more about that when we're in the chamber, and I'm sure other members will as well. So, Linda?
Sure, just to obviously echo what you've said, but the fact that you said how long it took us to read it would tell you how long it would be. Well, it doesn't even really give you an idea of how long we'd take to pull all that kind of stuff together and to really reflect so well and so accurately everything that was said. And it's the first time I've been part of a committee scrutinising legislation, and I think that probably very few committees have given the kind of scrutiny that we gave to this, and it was captured excellently. So the work, not only the work that was done and the amount of work and time that takes, the manner in which it was done and the report that came out at the end of it, not only was it very accurate and reflective, it was very easy to read and easy to follow. So excellent work by everybody involved. Thank you.
And I'll commend members as well, because they've done an excellent job, in my opinion. I've sat in a number of committees when we've scrutinised legislation. I know for some this was their first time. But it'll stand you in good stead now in future legislation. But for a lot of members, for their first time at this, they're really showing an expertise as well, which will be of great value going forward. So well done to all the members in respect of that. And hopefully I was as forbearing as I possibly could be, and maybe was frustrated on some occasions trying to get us to an agreed position, but I think we got there in the end, and we can be rightly pleased, I think, as a committee, the work that we've done in such a short period of time. So, okay, well, listen, in terms of an update just for the next stages on this, because ultimately we're trying to get this into law as soon as possible, the Minister has written and has provided an update on the timescales for the remaining stages of the bill. That correspondence was in the tabled pack, pages 224 and 225. And it outlines the passage of the bill. It's intended the consideration stage will be on the 10th of November, followed by further consideration stage on the 30th of November, with the final stage then taking place on the 8th of December. And the Minister has put on record her sincere thanks to the committee for its work on the bill. So, members, that's when we intend to move this into the next phase, into the Assembly, and I think that's something that victims will be particularly pleased to see because of the delays that they've had to face. And we made it clear that we wanted to do this ourselves, but there was always a risk that Westminster could have moved faster than us, but we've actually been able to move at pace, and I think we'll actually complete our work before Westminster will have completed their work. So,
not that it's a competition, but if it was...
No, but we would have been open to criticism if we had been behind them, so... okay. Let's go back to the item 7 on the agenda. Counter-terrorism Sentencing and Release Bill, pages 122 to 248 of the meeting pack. At our meeting on the 23rd of June this year, the committee considered correspondence from the Minister providing an update on developments in relation to the Counter-Terrorism and Sentencing Bill and the proposed approach by the UK Government to apply retrospectively provisions in a previous bill to remove the automatic right to early release within Northern Ireland. The committee noted that the Minister expressed a number of reservations regarding the bill and agreed to request further information from the Department on a number of issues. The Department's response was noted at the meeting of the 3rd of September. The Minister has now written to advise that she has received a request from the UK Government to bring forward a legislative consent motion to operationalise a number of provisions within the proposed Counter-Terrorism and Sentencing Bill. The Minister provided copies of the correspondence between the Minister and her UK counterparts. The Minister has also outlined that following discussions with executive colleagues, it was clear that there were difficulties in achieving consensus on this issue. The Minister wrote to her executive colleagues seeking written views and asking that the matter be tabled at the Executive on the 8th of October. She received one written response and the item was not placed on the Executive agenda for discussion. The Minister has concluded that given the differing views on this matter, there is insufficient support for either a limited LCM or for a full LCM. The deadline for a response to the UK Government was on the 9th of October. Therefore, she has written confirming that it will not be possible to secure legislative consent from the Northern Ireland Executive for the relevant provisions within the bill. So, members, that is by way of an update. In terms of some of the rules around this issue, the Standing Orders 42A4 provides that a minister whom devolution matters concerns shall normally not later than 10 working days after the relevant day either lay a legislative consent motion before the Assembly or, if unable to do that, lay a memorandum before the Assembly explaining why an LCM is not being sought. So, members, I know we could debate this. I have my own very clear view on this. I'm not at all happy with the decision that's been reached and the Minister's change of position on this whenever it was first raised. But I do think that there needs to be a proper debate on this now in the Assembly, and under the standing orders, there should be a motion brought forward. And this issue needs to get much further airing than what it currently has got, and people need to explain and justify the positions that they're taking on this issue. So my view is that that is something that should be done in the interests of transparency, and that I would propose to this committee that we would write to the Minister seeking confirmation that she intends to lay a memorandum before the Assembly explaining why an LCM is not being sought, and then, members, we will have this debate in that forum. Now, I'm happy for members to make comments at this stage on this. Linda?
I'm not going to make a lot of commentary because I've already made my point and they're on record. I don't think there's any value in going into it. I have a number of serious concerns around it, not least the fact that this relates to children from 10 years and up. And I don't even think that's in line with where our thinking would be going in terms of the age of responsibility. But that's by the way. I'm not really bothered about writing to the Minister to ask her to come before the House, because I think if she asked her executive colleagues for their views and one party responded to that, I think that says all that needs to be said. There are other parties within that executive that had an opportunity to give their views. I'm not saying that rules out an opportunity in the Assembly, but they thought it so important they didn't bother responding. And I just feel that point needs to be made.
Well, my party did meet with the Justice Minister and made it explicitly clear to the Justice Minister that she should be bringing forward an LCM to extend this. So, whilst there may be one minister that put something in writing, we engaged with the Justice Minister at her request, indeed, and expressed our very clear position on this issue. Paul Frew?
Yeah, so one thing is the subject matter, which I don't know that we'd need to get into here, but other than to say that national security and terrorism should be, or is, in fact, an accepted matter. So I would like to know the process that the UK government will now enter in adopting the legislation UK-wide sense. But also, notwithstanding the content, there's a process here and a principle, and it's very important that the executive ministers of this place adheres to the process to allow the Assembly to assess these things, because there's a clear definition between an executive minister and the Assembly. So I think with regards to that, it's only right that we question then the Justice Minister as to her process here. It seems to be through all the correspondence that the Justice Minister doesn't really like this herself, and that's clear. But then she's saying that she's not going to even try because there'll be a split in the executive, which could well be the case and probably is. In fact, we know it is. That in itself is not an excuse to stop the process, the due process that's meant to be there to give the Assembly its due regard. So I'm aggrieved about. I'm aggrieved that we won't be able to move this forward in an LCM. Notwithstanding the content on the LCM, I'm now concerned about the processes and how that will play out in the future. we should, as an Assembly, be able to air our views on this subject. That in itself could well inform debate in other places and could well inform and assist the Minister in moving forward. So I just don't understand why she hasn't followed process here. So yeah, I'm all in favour of writing to the Justice Minister. I'm also all in favour of writing to Chris Phillips, MP, to see what his next step will be in all of this. Because if we take a stand that if we ain't going to even test opinion in an executive, where are we for every and any LCM that would come before us? Now, I know there's parties that have a principled stand here with regards LCM is not a good device or to use, but sometimes it may be the only device that can be used in a short period of time. So, and if everything was content, if everybody was content with a certain bill and an LCM is all that was needed, why would you not use an LCM in that regard? So I'm just concerned about now about the process that has been adopted by the Justice Minister in this regard. And I agree 100% we should write to her and also then to Minister, Westminster, to ask for his next step. Thank you.
Doug?
Chair, I just want to put it on as well that our party also engaged with the Minister, and again, our position was for a full LCM in regards to this. And the important thing to remember is Northern Isles should never have been left off this legislation in the first place. You know, we certainly weren't left off the legislation which is going through at the minute on the covert human intelligence sources bill. You know, there was nobody leaving us off that. We should never have been left off this. We should have been on it in the first place. So we do need to have a discussion about this, and everybody will have a point of view, but it is an accepted matter. And I think Paul is absolutely right. We need to know what the UK government's next step is going to be, because if we're not going to put through an LCM, then UK government have within their rights to include Northern Ireland in the full legislation and put us through.
Is there any other comments members want to make before we...
It's more a question, Chair, and a question I have no idea what the answer is. That's sometimes dangerous to ask a question like that. Is it only the Minister? Is it only an Executive Minister can bring forward an LCM?
Okay, I'd ask Christine in advance of this. So, Christine, if you want to answer that, and then Sinead Bradley has indicated to come in.
Okay, understanding Order 42A5, it says a member of the Assembly, other than the Minister whom the devolution matter concerns, may lay a legislative consent memorandum, but shall not do so until A, the Minister has led a legislative consent memorandum under the above paragraph. The Minister has led a memorandum under paragraph 4B, which refers to her explaining why a legislative consent motion is not sought, and the 10 working days provided for in paragraph 4 have expired. So there is provision in standing orders, but it relates to
the Minister's action. You need to have a process first. You need the memorandum laid before a member can do that.
And that's in the gift of the Minister.
Standing order should be happening.
Yeah.
When a member brings it, it can't actually be implemented when it's brought by a member rather than the Minister, just to know it can be debated, but it can't be implemented based on a vote. What comes out of that? Just
does the vote become like a motion as opposed to a piece of legislation at that point?
Yep. That's exactly what it is.
I'm not sure. I need to check that.
We actually discussed it yesterday in procedures, not in relation to this, actually nothing to do with this, to be fair. We're doing work on LCMs, and it just happened to be one of the issues. Even Jerry Carroll raised the question around it. So it was clarified there that it is literally just a debate, and I think probably is a vote on it. I would imagine. So it's just treated as a motion, which it doesn't carry.
This is a great committee. See the learned members of this committee.
Sinead Bradley.
Only by pure fluke.
Thank you, Linda stole my thunder there. in procedures. But I suppose really coming at it, you know, setting aside the
topic or the subject matter, because I know that is controversial. But in terms of our committee role here, it would be good. This is the sort of thing that does exercise sort of clarity, you know, in terms of what are the options afforded to us at this stage. I'd just like to know, is there a wee bit of work we could do as a committee to find out how we navigate something like this? Just the options.
Maybe
it is worth writing to procedures and finding out. Just so that we have it right. I mean, I'm giving you what was relayed yesterday at a meeting, but
yeah.
I mean, to be fair to members, but it's only but right that you get something.
Okay, well, listen, there's a number of points here. There's one, the minister under the standing order should be laying a memorandum to explain why there isn't an LCM being brought. To me, that I don't regard that as a controversial issue. And I think the committee should be asking the minister, will she be doing this? And then there's the second issue about writing to the relevant UK minister to find out, in the absence of an LCM, what is their intentions? I'm not suggesting that we get a committee view that we're saying it should happen, because I don't think this committee will go down that route. But again, it would be a procedural question. What do they intend to do?
I will agree to both, but I would like, in terms of the letter that's going to the British government, that we have sight of it, because I wouldn't like that it would have any kind of tone that would give a view that is a committee view. I just have to be honest about it. But I think asking the questions, I think anybody should be allowed to ask any question they want.
No, I'm happy to make sure I don't do something that gets, well, I'm not going to bother about it. I compromise other members that didn't mark my card. So suitably marked, happy to chair. It'll be a factual, procedural question that's being asked. Okay, and then we'll get advice as to what is the options for an individual member, or indeed a committee, potentially, when it comes to, if a minister doesn't lay an LCM, is there the opportunity for a member to lay it, to give the same effect to it, or not? And that can go to procedures. It may be that we need to get advice, if it's not procedures, whether it's an illegal advice from the Assembly's legal people on that, around the rules to do with the standing order. Are members content that we explored the best advice, whether that's through procedures or to get from the Assembly's legal view on what the rules are for MLAs to bring forward an LCM in the absence of a minister doing it?
Don't stop you from getting any advice.
Okay.
I can stop you anyway, you get away, whether it's through the committee or
not. We need all the advice we can get.
Okay. Let's move on, members. Item 8, implementation of domestic homicide reviews. It's a written briefing paper, pages 250 to 254 of the meeting pack, and there's also an updated version that was in the briefing paper at the table pack at 227 to 230. The department has provided an update on the implementation of domestic homicide reviews. Where a death has arisen in familial, personal relationship, or same household circumstances, DHRs consider what happened and what, if anything, could have been done differently. They are intended to maintain good practice, identify and form improvements needed to frontline services, and ultimately learn from these tragic crimes to save lives in the future. They do not seek to apportion blame. The intention is for the Minister to launch domestic homicide reviews during December by commencing Section 9 of the Domestic Violence Crime and Victims Act 2004. Expected to be on the 10th of December. Any domestic homicide taking place on or after the commencement date will be considered against the criteria for conducting a DHR, but they will not be carried out for retrospective cases. So, members, it's there for noting in terms of an update on the implementation of domestic homicide reviews, unless members require any further information. Julie noted. Sorry.
I do. Just one, I'm content with the process, but in terms of the death by suicide, it says that it's about, you know, any deaths that are in familial you know, circumstances. Surely suicide would be covered in that, because it's a death. So I would just like a wee bit more information about why that's not been, it says on balance, we considered it. So just like a wee bit more information from why that's not included from the get-go. Because okay. That's certainly a big a big problem and a factor in after domestic abuse and likelihood of suicide, coming from experience. So I think that should be in there. If there is reasons why it's not, then that's okay. But
okay,
we need to look at.
So members are content we'll get a further rationale for the decision they've taken on that issue?
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Agenda item 9 then, pages 256 to 329, the department has provided an update on progress to deliver the action plan to address 4 strategic recommendations and 2 operational recommendations in the Criminal Justice Inspection Report of the Public Protection Arrangements in Northern Ireland that was published in October 2019. The department confirms 3 of the recommendations have been completed and 3 remain in progress. The department has advised in the response of 11th of March that in respect of strategic recommendation 4, it was anticipated that the research committee would provide a paper for the June meeting of the Papani Senior Management Board regarding information performance indicators. However, the update has not made any reference to progress in respect of the performance indicators. So if members are content, we'll request information on the progress in respect of the development of performance indicators. Unless there's any other information members need, then we'll action that point. And we'll note the rest of the progress report. Item 10 is the stocktake of placing oversight and accountability arrangements, pages 331 to 337 of your meeting pack. The Minister has advised of her intention to carry out a stocktake of the arrangements for placing oversight and accountability in May 2020. This will consider whether there are changes that would substantively improve the efficiency or effectiveness of placing oversight and accountability arrangements in line with the ethos of the A New Beginning policing in Northern Ireland, i.e. the Patton Report, and be capable of securing political agreement. So the Department has advised that the first stage will involve a targeted engagement with key bodies to foster collaborative working and jointly identify key issues to be considered during the stocktake. The key bodies are the Northern Ireland Policing Board, the Police Ombudsman, SGINI, PSNI, the HM Inspectorate of Constabulary Fire and Rescue Services, the Northern Ireland Audit Office, and this committee. The department has indicated that a further update will be provided to the committee once this engagement has been completed, and then an oral briefing can be arranged if the committee wishes to do so to discuss this further with the minister or officials. So once issues and proposals have been identified, members, the department plans to have a formal public consultation and further stakeholder engagement to obtain views on potential reforms. At the conclusion of the stocktake, a summary report will be prepared to include recommendations for change based on the recommendations that can achieve political consensus. It's recognised that some reforms may require legislation, and this will be subject to the normal policy development process and legislative scrutiny through the Assembly. So the Department has invited the committee to identify any issues that it considers would be helpful to examine as part of the stocktake. The Department is open to considering both changes that may require legislation and those that could be implemented administratively. So members, it's whether we wish to submit any issues for examination as part of the stocktake. It may be helpful that we would schedule an oral briefing then on the results of that targeted engagement once it happens as well with members, which I think makes sense. So I'm not sure members were in a position at this stage to highlight what type of things that we would want. I think it would be helpful if we got departmental officials first to come in and talk to us about, you know, the terms of reference that they're looking at, and through that I think we would be able to relay areas that would be worth looking into without any parties having to commit to what our own views at this stage would be. But we want to make sure that it's broad enough to be worthwhile doing, but also there's no point considering something that straight away we're just not going to agree to. So I think we'll schedule officials that are going to be taking this forward to come up to have a conversation with the committee, and then we can relay our views to them. If members are content, then we'll organise that. Okay, item 11, penalty notice for notices for disorder, changes the departmental guidance, page 339 to 362. At our meeting on the 10th of September this year, the committee considered a letter from the Minister regarding revision of the department's guidance in respect of penalty notice schemes introduced in the Justice Act of 2011. the use of penalty notices for disorders being extended. The committee agreed to request details of views of victim support on the revision to the guidance and clarity of the date from which the new thresholds would apply. The department response indicates that a task and finish group, which included victim support NI, discussed a number of proposed changes to the guidance. The department advised victim support's views that were wholly taken into account, and alterations to the proposed changes to the guidance were made in the course of that work. The final changes to the guidance document were fully accepted by victim support. The new thresholds for use of penalty notices for disorder apply from the 12th of October. So if members are content now to note the changes to the department's guidance in respect of penalty notice scheme introduced in the 2011 Justice Act. Correspondence. There's three items of correspondence. I'm going to draw attention to one of them. A memo from the Committee for Finance advising that it is written to all executive ministers requesting an overview of all bids submitted by each department within the in-year monitoring process and bids supported by costed proposals for COVID-19 related funding outside the in-year monitoring process, and a template was provided to each department for completion. So if members are agreed, we'll be asking the department to provide a copy of its response to the Committee for Finance to this committee. Also, just to highlight, this Agenny report relates to the debate even we had actually earlier in the week in the Assembly around modern slavery and human trafficking. This Agenny inspection report was published today. The report makes three strategic recommendations and eight operational recommendations and identified eight other areas for improvement. So members, if you're content, we'll request a copy of the response from the department and the justice bodies to the findings and recommendations that are contained in the inspection report, something that we can follow up then in due course. Members, content the action then, the other items as outlined in the clerk's memo. I have no chairman's business. Is there any other business? Okay, well then members, your next scheduled meeting is on the 22nd of October, which will be in the Senate chamber at 2 o'clock. So thank you members, meeting adjourned.
30. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Committee Room 30. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Committee.